week on Terra Verde.
On Saturday, June 18th, will be the Berkeley Farmers Market's Summer Solstice Celebration and Crafts Fair, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. in Civic Center Park. Live music by Daniel Berkman, The Wild Buds, Jazz Sabbath, and the Sons and Daughters of Orpheus will also present a seasonal ritual. Phone 510-548-3333. Again, that's 510-548-3333. The Berkeley Farmers Markets are ongoing benefits for the Ecology Center.
And this is 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1:30. Stay tuned next for Making Contact.
This week on Making Contact.
The salmon teach us humility, live within your means, this is where I belong. If the salmon manifest anything because they are the shuttle that weaves this whole ecosystem together, is a sense of community.
Without the salmon, there would be no Pacific Northwest as we know it. And yet, since 1991, most of the salmon runs in the Northwest have been listed as threatened or endangered. And this spring on the Columbia River, the fewest fish in years are returning upstream to spawn. On this edition, producer Barbara Bernstein takes us on a journey into the land of salmon. Why are they so significant, and what will it take to keep them from disappearing? I'm Justin Beck, your host this week on Making Contact, a program creating connections between people, vital ideas, and important information.
Must have been the fall of 1974, I guess. I went up the North Umpqua River to a place called Boulder Flats in the autumn and watched these salmon spawning. I didn't realize what I was watching at first, but there were these enormous fish, digging reds and the males fighting with each other, and it was the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen.
In the 1950s, my father took me up to Celilo Falls, and I saw salmon being fished and salmon being brought up under the rocks at Celilo. I was pretty young, but I knew that I was seeing something that was really extraordinary. When that dam was completed and when Celilo was gone, it meant that I would never see it again. It was a loss, and I knew that.
We fished at Celilo for thousands and thousands of years, and the salmon knew where it was to go to sacrifice its life to feed us. They knew where they were going, you know, like we knew where we were going. We knew our place on this planet, and everything was in balance. And then when the Europeans came and put dams in, it hurt. It displaced us. And now we have to fish special times a year in special places. We have in-lieu sites that the government gave us. And whoop-de-doo, you know, by the time we got the sites, there was no more salmon. And, you know, you just wonder where the balance is.
These are the voices of three Oregonians. Former State Governor John Kitzhaber, Bill Lang, Professor of History at Portland State University, and visual artist Lillian Pitt, who was born on the Warm Springs Indian Reservation in Central Oregon. She is descended from people who lived and fished along the Columbia River for 10,000 years. At one time, millions of salmon returned up the Columbia each spring, summer, and fall. But since 1991, a growing number of Columbia River salmon species have been listed under the Endangered Species Act. Despite 100 years of salmon recovery efforts, ranging from hatcheries to fish ladders to transporting young salmon by barge or truck around the river's dams, the runs continue to decline. When the Grand Coulee Dam was finished in the 1940s, it cut off over 1,000 miles of salmon habitat on the upper Columbia River and extinguished the legendary runs of June hogs, 70 to 100-pound salmon that once spawned there. Now, in a good year, a few hundred thousand salmon migrate up the Columbia to spawn. Many years, the numbers are much lower than that. Fishermen along the lower Columbia River, like John Westerholm, still remember when salmon seemed to be abundant.
I came along at a time when I could begin to see the numbers going down and the dams going in. But I don't think at that time that I could imagine that it would be as dire as it is today, especially towards the commercial fishing fleet, the gillnetters. But it was kind of sickening, I guess, to realize that that was the end of a whole subspecies of fish. I hate to admit that I was of a generation that saw that happen. The younger generation today, they don't really have the concept of what it was like to see them disappear.
It's fall 2004, and the Columbia River is enjoying the largest run of salmon in many years. I stand on the banks of Eagle Creek, a tributary of the Columbia just upstream from the Bonneville Dam. I am watching hundreds of fall Chinook salmon as they spawn. Scattered along the shore in small groups are parents with young children, teenage couples, young hikers, and middle-aged folks like myself, witnessing an event we may never see again.
The salmon don't believe they can't make it. Most of them don't, but they don't believe that.
Governor John Kitzhaber.
And they keep working to sort of fulfill their mission, which is to propagate the species and to provide nourishment for the next generation.
Fish travel through a whole circle of things, from babies up in the mountains with clear, fresh waters, hundreds of miles away from oceans. They get swept downstream, go into bigger waters. And if they're smart and fast and invisible enough and make it through dams, they get the chance to become adult fish.
Louis Pitt, a tribal member of the Warm Springs Indian Reservation, is director of government affairs and planning.
They take a right out in the Pacific Ocean and head up 1,000 to 2,000 miles and grow to be big fish. And they come back and they turn into freshwater fish again and go back up and start the whole cycle over again.
After the salmon have spawned and the children begin to hatch, the first thing they do is taste things.
Bruce Miller was a Skokomish Yakima who returned several years ago to live and teach on the Skokomish Reservation on the Olympic Peninsula, where he was born in 1944.
And what they're doing, according to the Indian teachings, is tasting their way down the river, all the way down to the ocean, to Tibioch Ti'ilad, the land of the great food, which is what we call the ocean. And before they get ready to return, the spiritual mother of the salmon calls them together out in the ocean. And it's there she blesses them and paints their mouth, so that the only water they can taste is the water they were born in. That's how she ensures they return to the stream that they were born in.
Every salmon species has evolved to focus on a different part of the watershed. Some penetrate deep into corners of the watersheds like coho and steelhead. Some are main stem spawners like chum and kings. Some spawn in systems only with lakes like sockeye.
Tom Jay is a sculptor and writer living in Chimicum, Washington.
And when they arrive there, they're either killed for food by large predators or they die and are outhauled by smaller scavengers. The work of the whole ecological community is to distribute this salmon largesse throughout the ecosystem.
They find that the carcasses dropped by the eagles and the raccoons and the bears off in the forest are adding actually a great deal to the nutrients of the forest. And they're finding that through this chain of things that salmon have been responsible for more than the health of just the people that feed off of them.
So if you measure trees in a mature Northwest Coast forest, you'll find that about nearly 50% of the carbon in the tree is a marine carbon. The soils that these huge trees are growing in are not naturally fertile. I mean, all you have to do is be in any part of the Northwest and dig down a couple of feet and you hit glacial till. The salmon co-evolved with this landscape, and over time they learned they had to die. They had to basically give up their bodies to the land so that it would become more fertile and grow forests. In that process, they evolved a whole forest ecosystem that was dependent on this great nutrient input from the ocean each year to survive.
If you take the salmon out of a river, you impoverish the entire ecosystem. The bears take the fish back into the woods.
Former Oregon Governor John Kitzhaber.
It's a story of renewal. It's a story of hope. It's a story of promise. And I think that's, in many ways, the story of the Northwest.
Salmon in our Aboriginal days was our wealth and ran in such great numbers that we had time on our hands to create forms of art that people who have less to eat don't have the time to perfect. One of our most significant, important rituals that we maintain to this day is the first salmon ceremony that honors the first salmon caught during that particular run. We, as the Aboriginal Asiltabu of this land, were vowed to honor the salmon for our coexistence with it here on this earth for the lifetime of our people. When we halt this care and concern for the salmon will dwindle, and so will our people, and so will our culture.
There isn't a hardcore promise that fish will always come back.
Warm Springs tribal member Louis Pitt.
We had to be very respectful and very honoring of those creations because you don't want to offend a fish. Even when you're fishing them and hitting them in the head with the club, you're humming a, you know, a song and thanks to the Creator and thanks for that fish for giving up his life and to help me live my life as an Indian person. And thank you, Nusuch, for all that you're giving me.
The salmon will be our barometer as human beings in the health of the water. And when we see the salmon dwindle, we know that we as humans are being warned that we are not maintaining our part of this original agreement.
We are a region that traditionally have been defined by nature's bounty. And perhaps the best example of nature's bounty in the Northwest, at least until the 20th century, were salmon.
Bill Robbins is an emeritus distinguished professor of history at Oregon State University.
Certainly, older generations remember salmon in relative abundance, but the current younger generations of Northwesterners, their touch with salmon is farm-raised salmon that they purchase in a restaurant or in the store and barbecue in the backyard, and they think they're eating real salmon. I worry that, you know, we may be losing the cultural significance of salmon, even to Euro-Americans who value the importance of wild salmon runs.
If you think about one of the things that are unique about a place, a lot of those are defined not just in terms of political boundaries, but they're defined in terms of the natural systems that exist in that place.
Seth Zuckerman works on watershed restoration efforts and writes articles and essays about salmon.
The salmon, by virtue of going out to sea small and coming back large, have fertilized the forests and valley floors of this place. And it also infuses something into the culture of the place. Salmon are present in the art, they're present in the poetry, they're present in the economics, they're present in the place names.
The listing of species of salmon in 1991 as endangered or threatened species has helped bring attention in a very large way to something that we've lost already in some respects or in danger of losing. The fact that school children are drawing images of salmon and artists are creating other images of salmon and so forth may be a way of keeping before the public attention the importance of salmon to the Pacific Northwest.
Out in the rainforest of Washington State's Olympic Peninsula, artists Sarah Mall and Tom Jay are working to bring back salmon runs to their corner of the Northwest by integrating their artwork into watershed restoration.
Our souls need to be reached somehow. We need to self-identify with the salmon that really is the key to everything that lives here. And if the salmon is okay, then we're okay too. If we're going to restore them, it's going to be because we care about them personally and we connect personally.
It was a full moon night, and I heard splashing in a creek that runs south of our home. So I went over, and I laid on this little footbridge, and here came this coho salmon swimming upstream. And I was a typical American. I have essentially been homeless most of my life. You know, my father moved from job to job, and we, as a family, moved from place to place. And here was this
creature who focused the whole notion of home into this very numinous, powerful, vital energy. And so I realized at that moment that if I was ever going to find my own way home, that this was the creature to follow.
You're listening to Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information or for cassette or CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit us on the web at radioproject.org. In a few moments, we'll return to Salmon Lands, produced by Barbara Bernstein.
In 1999, a slim red book called Salmon Nation began circulating around the Northwest. 3 years later, a Portland-based group, EcoTrust, started a social marketing campaign encouraging residents of the Northwest to declare themselves citizens of Salmon Nation. The idea was to acknowledge that our natural boundaries define our identity as much as our political boundaries. Seth Zuckerman edited Salmon Nation and worked on the Salmon Nation campaign.
Salmon Nation is the geography of place. And that's everywhere the salmon run or have run. And it's also a geography of mind. It's a way of thinking about where you live that includes salmon. And it's a geography of heart, because salmon are a species that once we get to know them, we care about them, not just because they're part of the sustenance that has sustained people here for thousands of years, but also because there's an amazing relationship there in a fish that hatches in the creeks near where we live, swims out to sea, spends years at sea, and then comes back. Those of us who see ourselves living in Salmon Nation, we shift the way we live our lives and the way we arrange how we live and societal decisions, our economic decisions. We shift those in subtle ways to take account of the fact that it's not just humans living in this place.
The Indian message over the years has been unbroken, and is that we need to take care of this place.
Warm Springs tribal member Louis Pitt.
And so America thinks about things in the short term, 2 to 3 to 4 year cycles. And we're just hoping that Pacific Northwest, as it's called now, can start honestly taking a look at the price of progress around us, the price of cheap power, just taking responsibility of yourself that there's more to life than just the bottom line dollar. I think there's a lot we still owe to the land and the waters that we need to start thinking about.
What defines progress in the Pacific Northwest is a series of hydroelectric dams that block the Columbia River and impede salmon runs. These dams provide Northwest ratepayers with the cheapest electricity in the United States. When salmon species started being listed under the Endangered Species Act, this dramatized the need to rethink the costs of progress. In an effort to replicate some of the river's natural flow patterns, the Bonneville Power Administration, who operates the dams, began spilling water over the dams when young salmon are running.
Spilling water over the spillways, rather than running them through the turbines, speeds the downstream migrants' progress to the sea, and it also, of course, keeps them out of the turbines.
Bill Lang, professor of history at Portland State University.
But every cubic foot of water that passes over a dam spillway, rather than through the turbines, is, of course, a sacrifice of economic value.
In 2001, the Pacific Northwest experienced the worst drought in 24 years. Flows in the Columbia were way below normal, endangering the young salmon's journey to the ocean. Because the river was so low, it was vital to spill water over the dams all summer long. But the dearth of rain was not the only abnormal thing going on. It was also the year that Enron manipulated the California energy market to boost its own profits. This caused rolling blackouts across the state and drove up energy prices up and down the West Coast. To deal with this crisis, the Bonneville Power Administration decided to curtail spills. As a result, Enron made windfall profits, but a high percentage of young salmon didn't make it to the ocean. The salmon that did survive in 2001 are now returning upriver in the lowest numbers seen in years.
This crowd tells me that we have a chance to save salmon. Your caring tells me that we can grow into a huge force that we are, show our determination, and recover salmon in the Northwest. For our sport, for our livelihood, for our sons, and for our daughters.
In September 2004, hundreds of Northwest fishermen sailed up the Columbia River to Portland. A mile of trucks pulling boat trailers clogged the freeway and local streets as his parade wended its way from the docks to a park near downtown. There, they rallied against federal government policies that they believe are destroying the salmon runs their livelihoods depend upon. Buzz Ramsey with the Northwest Sport Fishing Industry Association kicked off the rally.
You know, things are really out of whack when some of our political leaders would support a proposal that would kill 50,000 salmon and put thousands of Northwest residents out of a job for a measly 10 cents a month savings on our electric bills. It's insane. For the last 4 years, salmon have been managed on the Columbia River under a biological opinion brought out during the last months of the Clinton administration. It called for flow and spill on the Columbia River to move smolts downstream. It also called for timely check-ins to see how we're doing on recovering wild stocks. And it ultimately called for the breaching of the four dams on the Snake River if we didn't meet our goals. But the plan was only financed at a 50% level. How could it possibly work? It also contained a clause that allowed the hydro system to stop spilling water by simply declaring a power emergency. Less than a year into the plan, Bonneville cooperated with an Enron-induced power shortage and stopped spilling water for salmon. By stop spilling the water on the Columbia in 2001, we saw the worst in-river out-migration of smolts in history. And when those fish came back as adults, we saw short seasons, closed seasons, one fish limits. Because the 2000 biological opinion didn't model out recovery, we sued for a new plan and won. Now the current administration is introducing a new plan. The new plan suggests that dams are part of the landscape. I would like to call on you, every angler in the Northwest, and everyone that cares about salmon to remind the administration that God didn't give us dams, He gave us salmon.
Throughout most of my governorship, starting about 1995, I attempted to try to reframe that issue in the Columbia River, not, I think, with a great deal of success.
Former Oregon Governor John Kitzhopper.
But to me, the issue was to begin to talk about what it would really take if we as a region wanted to have very healthy runs of salmon, and then look at the price tag and find out how you would finance that. Who would be the winners and who would be the losers? And how could you create a way to do this where you'd minimize the losers? At the end of the day, we may say as a region, we're going to let the salmon go extinct because we're not willing to pay the price. I would object to that, but that's honest. That's honest. Right now we pay lip service to the importance of salmon and healthy watersheds, but we don't take the steps as individuals or collectively to make good on that.
I don't know that this place would be fit for habitation if you managed to wipe out one of the most resilient species on the face of the earth.
Olney Pat is a member of the Warm Springs Tribe and the director of the Columbia River Intertribal Fish Commission.
I mean, we don't think of them as something that you can trade for something else. You know, we can't say that. I think you can take 50,000 of them and sacrifice them in the name of 50 cents off on my next power bill. Our link to them goes back so far that we're just unable to think of them in the same terms as other people.
We need to get away from looking at salmon in terms of cost-benefit analysis.
Oregon State University history professor Bill Robbins.
It's proved antithetical to the existence of salmon since the Army Corps of Engineers first started doing surveys in the 1930s on the building of dams on the Columbia River. And there were great hearings in 1945, 1947 in Walla Walla, Washington, and so forth. Testimonies from people who were speaking on behalf of dams, those who were speaking on behalf of fish, they all talked about the issue of the survival of salmon. The builders, the proponents of dams, assured the public that we could have fish in dams too, by mitigation factors, hatcheries, by creating salmon refuges, and so forth. And none of that has worked.
Here's the thing with the hydroelectric system. It would be nice if we hadn't done it. But we did it, and at the time it made a great deal of sense. One can argue that Grand Coulee Dam helped win the Second World War. I mean, it made the aluminum plants possible. If we as a region want to reconfigure it, we as a region would have to say, well, we're going to stop being dependent on hydroelectric energy. We are going to make fundamental decisions about conservation, in how we build, in how we live. We're going to reduce our demand. And where I take exception with the dam breaching philosophy is that's supposed to be a silver bullet. We can just take the dams out. None of us have to do one thing to change our lifestyles or to make our lives a little bit less convenient. We'll just take the dams out and that'll fix it. Well, it won't fix it. There are huge non-point source pollution issues, not all of them coming from timber and agriculture. Look at the amount of stuff that washes into the Willamette River every day right off of roofs and lawns and streets and driveways in suburban Oregon. And taking out the dams doesn't affect that at all. So it's a complicated issue, but at the end of the day, it requires individuals to make a personal commitment and some personal sacrifice for this larger objective.
The majority of Northwesterners continue the debate over what sacrifices must be made and who must make them in order to restore salmon runs. But this discussion leaves Native people, like Warm Springs tribal member Olney Pat, a bit incredulous.
I don't think the tribes have ever thought of pushing them to the brink just to see how much more money you can squeeze out of the river. We'd rather go the other way. We'd rather see the dams breached and, you know, we get back to where we were. We're used to life changes. I mean, you know, we got taken from the river and put on a reservation. I'm sure we could live without these lights. I mean, that's, we could do a lot if the river were back the way it was.
We talk about the prospect of the salmon returning as they once did, and the land being pristine like it once was, we know is not a realistic thing.
Skokomish Yakima, Bruce Miller.
We can do so much. But as our old people say, the past never comes back. It's always left behind. It's the future that we look for, and the key philosophy for me is maintain. Maintain what we still have.
I'd like to have hope that we're going to have non-Indians around us that are going to finally open their eyes and see.
Warm Springs tribal member, Louis Pitt.
I think there's a lot of power in people being in a place over time. And just 4 or 5 generations, as I hear the farmers and ranchers brag about where they've been, I guess isn't enough, because some of those folks don't get it. It's not much I can do but try to live my life my way and maintain that hard message, is that there is another way to think and live with these resources.
I think the salmon will survive. I think they'll survive longer than the people. There was a time when the Columbia River was blocked off. I think they will find someplace else. If not in the Columbia Basin, they'll find someplace else. And then when the people are gone and the dams wash out, and they'll return. When all the nuclear waste, all the half-lives have blinked out, that the salmon will be back in the river again. And the question is whether we'll be here.
This program is dedicated to the memory of Bruce Miller. For Making Contact, this is Barbara Bernstein in Salmonland.
That's it for this edition of Making Contact, written, narrated, and produced by Barbara Bernstein. Thanks for listening. Our theme music is by the Charlie Hunter Trio. Additional music by Primo and Mike, Vi Hilbert, Johnny Moses, and Barbara Bernstein. Special thanks to Gail Trembley, Lillian Pitt, and Louis Pitt. This project was funded in part by the Regional Arts and Culture Council and Sound Partners for Community Health, a project of the Benton Foundation with funds from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Making Contact is an independent production funded primarily by generous gifts from the community. We are committed to providing a unique forum for voices and opinions not often heard in the mass media. For a cassette or CD copy of program number 2205, call the National Radio Project at 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit our website at radioproject.org. Lisa Rudman is our executive director, Pauline Bartolone, associate producer, Dorian Taylor, communications manager, Esther Mania, office manager, Tom Evans, development associate, Peggy Law, founding director, Norman Solomon, senior advisor, David Barsamian, national advisor, and I'm your host and associate producer, Justin.